Good morning. If you are somebody who looks at the sermon title and really listens for that, you're in bad luck today. On Friday, I said to Al, I'm changing the whole thing. So it's really more about guidance than about power. But any given scripture has many, many applications, many directions it can go. And it just felt like the Lord was leading me in a different direction than what I had told Martha to put in the bulletin. So at any rate, let us come together to hear the scripture read and proclaimed. And will you first join me in prayer, please? Gracious God, this is your word that we are about to hear, and we are so grateful for it. We pray that you would shed your light on it and in our minds and deep into our hearts, that we would be able to take in your word and be changed into the delightful image of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and in whose name we pray. Amen. The scripture this morning is from Acts. It's mostly chapter 13, but I'm starting in 12:25 through 13:12. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. The two of them, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. When they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues. John was with them as their helper. They traveled through the whole island until they came to Paphos. There they met a Jewish sorcerer and false prophet named Bar-Jesus, who was an attendant of the proconsul Sergius Paulus. The proconsul, an intelligent man, sent for Barnabas and Saul because he wanted to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the sorcerer, for that is what his name means, opposed them and tried to turn the proconsul from the faith. Then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elymas and said, "You are a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. You are full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. Will you never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord? Now the hand of the Lord is against you. You are going to be blind for a time, not even able to see the light of the sun." Immediately mist and darkness came over him, and he groped about, seeking someone to lead him by the hand. When the proconsul saw what had happened, he believed, for he was amazed at the teaching about the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, have you heard about the man who was doing really well at meeting his goal of losing some weight? He was eating healthier and exercising, even redirected his route to work to avoid the temptation of a bakery on the way. Until one day when he came into work carrying a rich caramel coffee cake, and his coworkers started getting after him about it, but he said, "Well, I accidentally took my original route to work this morning, driving by that bakery. I prayed, asking for a sign from God. If there was a parking spot right in front of the door of the bakery, that would be a sign from God that I should go in and buy something." And sure enough, after the eighth circle around the block, there it was. Well, I'm not sure that guy really wanted a sign from God. He wanted what he wanted and found a way to get it, regardless of God's opinion. And I saw another cartoon the other day that has a picture of a guy walking under the eaves of a roof. And in the, you know, little speech bubble, the guy is saying, "Give me a sign, Lord, hit me over the head." And at the same time, a guy up on the roof has just accidentally kicked a can of paint off of it right in the direction of the guy's head down below. Oops, be careful what you ask for. But it seems like everyone wants direct and clear communication from God. We say things like, if only God would give me a sign or speak in a loud voice, tell me what he wants, then I would do it. But God doesn't drop signs in front of our faces, except in the cartoons, and rarely do we hear an audible voice that we can attribute to God. In the Middle East, it isn't unusual for God to reach people through their dreams. But in the Western world, we don't even have many dreams that we can say come from God. It seems like Christians haven't really cultivated that listening relationship with God that allows him to guide us in making decisions or knowing what God wants of us. There are certain people, of course, who do routinely listen to God and often sense what God wants and what he says, but they seem few and far between. While the ordinary people in the pew, ordinary people like me, have given up trying. We assume God doesn't really communicate with us in a way we can hear or understand. I wonder if we followers of Jesus know God wants to talk to us and does talk to us, but we put up roadblocks. It takes some effort to be in relationship with God, and I don't know if we always want to make the effort that is required. Thinking of your human relationships in which naturally there is back and forth communication, what did it take to get to the point where you'll ask for advice and trust that it'll be worth listening to? Well, it took time to get to know a person, to know their values and perspectives. There were shared meals and long walks and talks. There was listening to understand and talking to make yourself known. Relationships take time and effort, and in the end, we have a trusted friend, one who we assume would think of our best interests when we ask for advice. There's also that other aspect of a friendship where you spend so much time with a person, it gets to the point where you know their voice, like on the other end of a phone, without them even ever telling you who it is. It has a particular pitch and quality, so you know. We can have this kind of relationship with God too, where we know the quality of his voice, as well as trust what he'll say is for our good. But what about people who don't even realize that God wants to communicate with them and give them the guidance they're looking for? I don't know if we think he's too big, too far away, too important or busy to bother with us, or we're not important enough, or our problem isn't, so why should we bother God? Some people just have no idea what God is like or that there's opportunity for a relationship with him. That is probably the case with Sergius Paulus, the proconsul or governor of Cyprus. He's a Gentile, so we don't really expect him to have any friendship with God. But he knew about God because he had this Jewish advisor named Elymas. Sergius was intelligent and probably wanted guidance and advice for governing his people and covering his bases in that polytheistic society. He sought out a Jewish prophet. Unfortunately, the governor didn't have enough information about the one true God, because if he had, he'd know that a Jewish sorcerer is an oxymoron. The God of Elymas is the only God, and practicing dark arts like calling up other spirits in order to predict the future or get guidance was strictly forbidden, a type of idolatry. The text also tells us that Elymas is a false prophet, another serious offense against God. The Old Testament law speaks explicitly against both of these activities, magic and false prophecy, each of them incurring serious consequences. But the governor didn't know that. He only knew Elymas had powers, probably some way of divining the future, and allegedly spoke the word of God, which would be helpful to the governor. Elymas is a villain, which conjures up pictures of black mustaches and evil-looking eyes and a sneering expression. But probably he was smooth, charming, also intelligent, flattering, possibly good-looking. And in spite of Sergius's great intellect, he was taken in by him. This unsuspecting governor chose to listen to a charlatan who made up lies. Even if we can feel sorry for Sergius, or at least sympathetic to his case, it was a serious error. He sought guidance in the wrong place. Not only would he get lies and bad advice, but it could have been dangerous. Elymas wasn't advising Sergius for the governor's good, but for his own power and gain. Who knows how far it would have gone had Paul and Barnabas not shown up and met the two men. But they did come to Paphos by divine appointment. See, God does guide his people. We call God creator and father. He knows all things and is always good. When Jesus came, God with us, he showed us that God is good, powerful, loving, healing, and forgiving. When he left earth to go back to his father, he promised he'd be with his disciples forever, and that his presence would be through the Holy Spirit, who God would send at Pentecost. God wants to be with his people, and he wants to give them the best guidance for making plans and decisions. In the beginning of the passage, Paul and Barnabas were with a group of disciples of Jesus, all praying together and worshiping. At that time, they understood the voice of God to be telling them to set the two of them apart for the work to which he'd called them. Now, when Paul was converted back on the Damascus Road, God had told him that he was appointing him to take the good news of God's love to the Gentiles and their kings. But it seems like at this specific time, while he was still in Antioch with the other brothers, after the voice of God gave that general call, they continued fasting and praying, I think, to get more clarity on exactly what this work was that God was calling them to. Where to go? Who to talk to? I think God told them to head to Cyprus, which they did right away. They started on one end of the island and traveled all the way across it, ending up here in the capital where they met Elymas, the Jewish sorcerer. God guided them to his boss, Sergius, who had an interest, maybe even a hunger, to know about God. And Paul continues to show that God guides us as he and Barnabas are teaching Sergius about the Lord, but Elymas is doing all he can to keep him from believing. But Paul and the Holy Spirit will have their way. Paul looks the sorcerer right in the eye and calls him out. He sees the evil within him and calls him son of the devil and accuses him of telling lies, recalling when Jesus called Satan the father of lies. Paul says he makes crooked the straight paths of the Lord. I'm sure you know what that means. Probably his guidance had that ring of truth, 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 all woven through, but with a twist. That was just not right, not of God. He took the ways of God and distorted them to be something else. Paul calls it what it is, lies. And he goes on to tell Elymas that he'll be blind for a time, not even able to detect light. And immediately it was so. Elymas started groping about for someone to lead him by the hand. A just ending. At the beginning, he sought to lead Sergius away from the faith. Now he's seeking someone to lead him anywhere. Well, I don't see how Paul could have said the things he said and brought on the blindness with such confidence unless he were being guided by God. And in fact, Luke tells us he was full of the Holy Spirit just before he confronted Elymas. God came to him with his good divine guidance, and Paul knew what to do. And don't question whether it was good that Paul brought blindness on the other man. Again, it was just. His guidance, instead of shedding light for Sergius, would keep him in the dark, cause him to make decisions and count on future events based on lies. Worse still, it would direct him farther away from the God he was seeking, into darkness rather than into the light. He relied on magic coming from the realms of darkness. The punishment that he would live in darkness for a time fit the crime. And who's to say that it was not God's grace that he made him blind for a time? Paul himself was blinded at his conversion. And he became what he was now, a wholehearted, devoted follower of Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, and willing to go anywhere and do anything God asked of him. Were Paul and the others looking for God's guidance when they were worshiping? Were they asking him what to do? We don't really know, but they certainly don't seem taken off guard. They seem to know that as they worship and pray, God will show up and speak to them, respond to their prayers. If they weren't asking, they were expecting. Paul and Barnabas, too, as they traveled, expected Jesus to be their constant companion through the Holy Spirit, and he faithfully gave them the power to discern and carry out his will. Sergius Paulus was impressed with the miracle Paul performed, speaking a word and causing Elymas to be blind. He was as much stirred by the teaching about Jesus who loved him, and he became a believer. He wouldn't need Elymas for advice anymore because now he would have Jesus with him all the time. It would take time and effort on his part and Paul's as his teacher. But as he developed his relationship with the Lord, he would learn to trust that he truly had his best interests at heart and would learn to discern his voice, his leading. We can learn to discern God's leading too. As the congregation comes together in worship and prayer each Sunday and at special times, we can come expecting God to be there, hearing our prayers and ready with an answer. As we listen for answers about how to move forward in mission or how to respond to any given situation or anything else that we're thinking about, we can expect to hear together, like those prophets and teachers in Antioch, whatever God wants to say. Maybe he wants to send a few of us out on a specific mission. Maybe he wants others to stay put and build up the church here. Right now, committees are meeting to plan our next year's budget. Let's make sure each group spends some time in worship and prayer, asking God, what do you want us to do next year? How can we best spread your gospel? And then take some time to listen for God's answers. Expect guidance. Why wouldn't he want to enter into the discussion with us? It's God's work we're professing to do. Did you ever work on a project with someone where they were the expert and you were the helper or even a learner? Think of something that you did with a parent, maybe, like building a birdhouse or working on a car engine, maybe cooking a meal or learning to sew. As you went along and came to some problem you couldn't solve, you asked your mom or dad. And they gave you advice, showed you how to proceed, helped you learn the next step. Sometimes they saw what was happening before you asked, and they spoke up to guide you. While you were working on the project, you expected your parent to tell you in one way or another how to get it done well. And especially if you were helping them on something they wanted done, like a house maintenance project or something, you knew they would give you the instruction they needed. Well, our work is God's project. He wants it done well, and he wants our help. When we need instruction, we can expect to get it from him. Perhaps God doesn't drop signs in front of our faces like cartoons. He works more subtly, and he requires that we pay attention. As individuals, we are to cultivate a relationship with God and listen for him and obey what we hear from him. It will take some time and experimentation to develop the ability to know the quality of his voice, time to learn to trust that he has our best interest at heart. But if we will take some time to listen and share our experiences with one another so we can practice together hearing God, we will learn that he is always there, ready to give us the word that we need. Just this morning before church, I had two different conversations where people told me that God spoke to them. One of them, the person directly asks, "Where is it, Lord?" And he immediately saw the thing he was looking for. And the other was just things that worked out as they sought God's leading. And they could tell this was God. This is what they wanted them to do, what he wanted them to do. So I hope you will expect God's guidance. Amen.